first of all, the larger structure that I think is most interesting and which I tried to really bring out into the mainstream awareness in the book is around the role that these things called microRNAs play. And so basically, just in short, when the first draft of the Human Genome Project ended in 2005, and they were anticipating finding a massive amount of genes to account for the massive amount of proteins in the human body. So one cell has something like 100,000 different proteins. So in the old model, one gene makes one protein. So they thought they'd find at least 100,000 proteins. And there they have the blueprint of all illness, and they could figure out how to cure people of disease. But they only found about 21,000 genes, about the same as an earthworm. So, you know, clearly the protein coding genes in the human genome weren't enough information to account for the infinite complexity of the body. So it was really kind of disillusioning. But one of the things that did come from that is that there's something called the dark matter of the human genome, which is the 98% of other other genes that are not transcribed into proteins, much of which is called RNA. And that those RNAs include microRNAs. Now it sounds small, but they have a huge effect because these non-coding, meaning they don't translate to proteins. In fact, they actually interfere with protein synthesis and therefore are really amazing master regulators because they can silence gene expression. They are believed to control or in some way influence the majority of the protein coding genes in the human body. So they're master regulators. Now, what's interesting about them is that they are packed into these little nanoparticles that are indistinguishable from what we call viruses. In fact, they're called exosomes, and these nanoparticles were first called viral-like particles because they're so similar. In fact, that's the big argument you could make, is that viruses are generally misunderstood exosomes. Needless to say, the thing about this new way of understanding biology is that these exosomes are capable of jumping from cell to cell between individuals in a species and then cross kingdom between, you know, say animals and plants. So that means that basically, if you are eating a fruit, the microRNAs packaged in that amazing food can affect the expression of our genes. And therefore, we don't actually have hermetically sealed off genomes from all the other things in life. There's this open, decentralized, horizontal flow of information happening constantly. So when you're talking about, like, for example, bacteria in the gut, they're all producing exosomes all the time, and all the cells are. So there's constant dialogue going on between the two. So a bacteria in your gut can influence the phenotypal expression of pretty much any cell in your body and could recruit certain stem cells to perform certain essential functions. So technically, it changes the game on everything we once thought, which was, again, we're like these machines and the code is inside this nucleus, which is hermetically sealed off from the rest of the world. And there's only a one-way direction out, you know, inside out for information. And that's how things work. We're like computers and little robots. Totally destroys that vision, where now everything is somewhat permeable. And what you do or don't eat, the bacteria or soil you are or aren't exposed to, is as important as any gene in the human genome in terms of one's health destiny, our level of well-being, our resilience. So it's, you know, it's sort of a complex topic, but I feel like people need to understand why it's so important to see food as information, and why, again, you know, this topic around even at polyphase farms, why plants and animals working together is what heals the biosphere and ultimately the human body. It can't necessarily be separated out.